What you got there, Christian?
Got a beautiful fan.
Sweet. All right. I might take one for myself.
What a beautiful day. Welcome, family and friends. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We have come together in the presence of God this day to witness the marriage of Aaron Oda and Susannah Wagner. We have come together to celebrate the marriage covenant, a gift from God, in which two people become one flesh in Christ, promising to be loyal to each other without reservation through lifelong commitment. We have come together to pray with Aaron and Susannah that as they transition into a new time of life with new responsibilities and new possibilities, they do so as witnesses of Christ and his kingdom, discipling and raising new generations into the way of Jesus. We have come together today to confess that as a community of faith, the health and happiness of this marriage is to some extent our responsibility. We commit ourselves, therefore, to view this union from this day forward as something precious, something sacred, God ordained, a union that we will only encourage and never discourage. Let us pray together. Gracious God, you have taught us through Jesus Christ that love is the fulfilling of the law, and that perfect love casts out all fear. Grant to these servants that loving one another, they may continue in your love until their lives end. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
First John 4:13-19. We know that we live in him and he in us because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in him and he in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in him. In this way, love is made complete among us so that we will have confidence on the day of judgment. Because in this world we are like him. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. We love because he first loved us.
All we need is love. Everybody, all we need is love. Bam, ba, da, da, da. All we need is love. Love. Love is all we need. Love is all we need. The scriptures that Aaron and Susannah have chosen today are all about love, which is appropriate. And it would seem that, like John Lennon, the British rock star, John the Apostle also believed that in the end, all you need is love. There is an inherent danger in that sort of talk, though, isn't there? The term love is simply a word waiting a definition. So the question we seek to answer, if all you need is love, is what is love? If you Google the word love, you'll find that there are over 7,750,000,000 different results. That is to say that when you ask the world via a Google algorithm, what is love, you get a little bit more than one answer per every human that lives on Earth. The first words you see as a definition are an intense feeling of deep affection. In this way, our culture overwhelmingly defines love as an emotion. The Urban Dictionary describes love like this: the most spectacular, indescribable, deep, euphoric feeling for someone. Goes on to say, love can make you do anything and sacrifice for what will be better in the end. Love is intense and passionate. Everything seems brighter, happier, and more wonderful when you're in love. And then it ends with this ominous note. If you can find it, don't let it go. In this way, love almost becomes like an all-fulfilling God within our culture. Something we turn to fulfill and meet all of our needs. As Christians, we can affirm that passion is a significant aspect of love. But what happens to a culture when emotion becomes the central definition of love? For many of us, we know this. We're aware that love is more than an emotion. We know that love is an action. That love is about choices and attitudes. It's about covenant and commitment. Love is a verb. That is, love is something that you choose to do. But today's passage, however, would speak just as strongly to those of us who often think of love as a craft that you must learn how to master. While it is true, again, action is an aspect of love. Love is an attitude that you must commit to in your marriage every single day. But, like emotion and passion before it, something can go terribly wrong when we allow our action to become the central definition of love. So if emotion and action alone are not the proper definition that will lead us into a full vision of what God means by love, then what will? Verse 7 and 8 of chapter 4 in 1 John reads like this: Beloved, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. God is love. These three words seek nothing less than to reorient the world. The world around us is built upon the premise that love is God. And because love is a word awaiting definition, our consumerist culture can then define love in terms of fleeting emotional highs. And as you flail around, your life revolving around trying to acquire yet another of these emotional highs, the world around us steps in and offers you an array of consumer products, each one promising to help you to be the person you need to be in order to sustain such a high. The body of Christ, broken for you. The body of Christ, broken for you, Susannah. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and he said, "This is the cup of my covenant, the new covenant in my blood. Drink of it as often as you do in remembrance of me." The blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim our Lord's death until he returns. Join us in singing, "Come Thou Fount."
Come Thou Fount of every blessing, to my heart to of mercy never ceases, call for songs of honest praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mount I fixed upon it, mount of thy unchanging love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I've come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me. from danger, interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor, daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy grace now, like a fetter, bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it. Prone to leave the God I love. Hear my heart, oh, take and seal it. Seal it for thy courts above.
I invite the parents of Aaron and Susannah to stand. I, Aaron, give myself to you, Susannah, to be your husband. I will love you selflessly and unconditionally. I eagerly anticipate the chance to grow with you, participating in the woman you are becoming, and choosing to love you each day from this day forward. I will work by your side to create a life of compassion, kindness, and adventure. When we are in strife and conflict, I will trust the Holy Spirit working in you. May our joy and love of Christ sustain our relationship and spill forth in love and service to others. May we work towards a life that reflects the peace, equality, and justice of God's kingdom. Susannah, I love you. You're my best friend. Your beauty, companionship, spontaneity, and humor make me fall in love with you more and more each day. I promise to love you in the good times, the bad times, the great times, and the mundane times. I humbly pledge my life to you, sharing our dreams and goals with one another, no matter what lies ahead, for as long as we both shall live.
I, Susannah, give myself to you, Aaron, to be your wife. I will love you selflessly and unconditionally. I eagerly anticipate a chance to grow with you, participating in the man you are becoming, and choosing to love you each day from this day forward. I will work by your side to create a life of compassion, kindness, and adventure. When we are in strife and conflict, I will trust the Holy Spirit is working in you. May our joy and love of Christ sustain our relationship and spill forth in the love and service to others. May we work towards a life that reflects the peace, equality, and justice of God's kingdom. Aaron, I love you. You are my best friend. Your thoughtfulness, loyalty, companionship, resilience, and humor make me fall in love with you more and more each day. I promise to love you in the good times and the bad times, in the great times and the mundane times. I humbly pledge my life to you, sharing our dreams and goals with one another, no matter what lies ahead, for the as long as we both shall live.
Susannah, I give you this ring as a symbol of my love for you.
Susannah, I give you this ring as a symbol of my love for you.
And my commitment to always be faithful to you.
And my commitment to always be faithful to you.
Aaron, I give you this ring as a symbol of my love for you.
Aaron, I give you this ring as a symbol of my love for you.
And my commitment to always be faithful to you.
And my commitment to always be faithful to you.
By the authority given to me by God, His church, and you, His witnesses, I declare that you are husband and wife. and you may kiss the bride. I present to you Mr. and Mrs. Aaron and Susannah Oda. And what God has joined together, let no one separate.
You go back.
Aaron, Susannah, thank you for letting me be part of this wedding. Aaron and Susannah, to me, they're like two apples in an orchard. They're like two grapes in the same cluster. To me, they're like pizza dough. Sorry, this is my grocery list. Sorry. All right. I apologize. All right. Aaron and Susannah. I'll start from the beginning. I met Aaron 29 years ago. I literally opened my eyes and there he was. Being born premature, we were in and out of the hospital, and we actually were born with like two slight birth defects. Sorry, Aaron. Aaron was born actually with two thumbs on one hand, which he's since got it removed. And I, on the other hand, had the more lucky deal of having a bright red birthmark on the middle of my forehead. So naturally, in elementary school, we convinced our friends we were aliens. We had our own twin world, one where our fascinations and interests and humor belonged to the two of us and became a source of pure joy. We loved reading scary stories, and we would try to convince our parents to let us watch whatever movie we wanted to, and it always ended, well, just disastrous results. We loved superheroes, and during our regular playtimes, I was always Batman, and Aaron was always Superman, because, let's be honest, nobody likes Robin. Thank you. I was hoping there'd be like a laugh track that you just like press at some point. Okay. As we grew up and matured, I saw Aaron become the young man that he is today. I saw his ambitions and passions, but also his vulnerabilities. And I understood him to be a compassionate and driven individual, always looking for the good and the beautiful in theology, the arts, and pretty much in humankind as a whole. And it's this commitment towards family, friends, and God that I saw, and I just kind of interpreted it as a quest for a very like rich love. I think that's what he wanted, and I could see it in his field of study and the way that he treated others, strangers, animals. Even though we separated during college to go to different schools, we always kept a very close touch, and we always discussed things, and for that, I'm like super grateful. However, Susannah, this was suddenly and violently interrupted when Aaron met Susannah. Suddenly, Aaron was taking longer and longer to get in touch with me. I would send him a cool link or a cool joke or something, and he would just see as like seen and not respond to me. And so I kept wondering like, what's up? And then he just kind of would tell me like, oh yeah, I've met this girl in Virginia. And I think my response at the time was, bro, really? Of course, I'm hugely exaggerating. When I first met Susannah, she was as lovely and intelligent and charming as everybody can see here today. I had written as I grew to know her, but it was actually really that first meeting that like I immediately felt a good feeling about you and I liked you. And it was that first meeting that I kind of secretly wanted you to be my sister-in-law. So like I just felt that Aaron just needed some kind of like push to get the ball rolling. So I was thrilled that they announced their engagement. And Susannah, it's with my utmost joy that we welcome you to the Oda family. And for you two, this is just the beginning. As the days turn into years, the years turn into decades, Aaron, you'll continue to appreciate Susannah's nature, her sweetness, her nurturing personality, but also her complexities. And Susannah, you will learn to live with Aaron's complexities. Let that one sink in. No, but also his caring nature, his courage, and his increasingly bizarre sense of humor, which will only grow more hilarious and more brilliant as time goes on. But above all, I hope that you guys are prime examples for the rest of us and me, examples in the powerful, graceful, and mysterious story of love. Thank you.
And our next speech from the matron of honor, Emily.
This is good though. Yes. Okay. I'm Emily. I've known Susannah for about 9 years now, so short of the 20 more that, you know, Aaron. But, and I was trying to think of what this speech would kind of do and its purpose, and I just decided I wanted to encourage and affirm characteristics I see in Susie that will help her in the marriage, and that will just totally bless and perfect your walk together. And I knew I needed to limit it, and it's not my gift to limit things. I could talk about Susie forever, but 9 years, so 9 things, and some of them I'll try to be quick. But so first off, your budget will be totally fine. Like, I don't think you should worry about that. If you meet Susie, at least 2 items on her are borrowed, even this dress today. So, I mean, it's always tweaked, and she makes it work, and it's incredible. She looks beautiful, but I don't think they'll have to worry about a budget or any kind of money because Susie's spending habits. If any of you have an old belt you want to give to her, she'll take it. So that's a really good thing. And she'll have no issue with the name change. I think that'll be really an easy thing because one of my favorite stories about Susie, half of you here today know her as Susannah. Another part of us knows Susie. Oh, there was a point when I called her Swags, and some of us still do that. We're still working on Swoda, I don't know. One of my favorite stories, she's at my church like 4 years ago, and we were kind of talking about how she was transitioning back into telling everyone that she was Susannah. And somebody comes up and introduces themselves to her and then goes, "What's your name?" And she looks at them and she just pauses and she's shaking their hand and she's saying nothing and I'm just waiting. And then all of a sudden she goes, "I don't know." So she's very comfortable with change. And I heard a really wonderful author say recently, like, how somebody goes up to him and asks, you know, "How can you be married for somebody for 40 years? I mean, that's just so long. Don't you get bored?" And he said, he was quick to say, "No, I'm not married to the same person for 40 years. They have changed dramatically since the first day I met them. And I know that Susie will be a change agent of always paying attention to who her identity is and her name." And that's gonna be easy. And she just has interesting hobbies. We all know that, and I just wanted to mention it. But it's really cool because it's not just hobbies, it's like her way of being. I mean, we had our bachelorette 2 nights ago, and I didn't plan this, but at the end of it, we were coloring all the things we had talked about on one big poster board. And because she wants to share, I think, her hobbies too, which is just a really wonderful quality. It's not just for her personal gain. She's also always searching for the truth in just the present moment. Ever since I've known you, you've just been so attuned to like what needs to be communicated and how it needs to be communicated. And just, you're just not afraid to ask questions. Sometimes I could be, like I like them, but you will just search for the answer forever and dive deep knowing that God is in the underneath, no matter how long it takes you and how far you have to dive. And that's just a wonderful way that you search for truth, and I know that will help you in your marriage. And then I just wanted to give a shout out to Kathleen and Ron for naming her middle name Joy. I mean, she is Joy, and she's known so much pain and heartache too, and I think she's Joy because she knows how to grieve well and to be present and to know herself and those she loves and work hard, and she is Joy, so that's really good. And that leads me to how compassionately strong you are. When I wasn't sure about this speech and I was like tempted to do a sermon, I was like thinking about, and I didn't, so thank you, welcome. But I was thinking about a passage. I remember when we were first going to the church that we kind of met at more, or like started going to, I don't remember if you were there, but there was just a really good sermon on the passage in Exodus where Aaron and Hur are holding up Moses' hands. And as long as Moses' hands are held up, they win the battle. But Moses is getting tired, and so Aaron and Hur hold their hands up. And just to do a pun for all the dads out there, it's like Aaron and Hur. But anyways, but you've just really like helped me hold myself up and not just like take over or try to take things away. And I see that so much in you, Aaron, too. Like, you empower people, and that's a really strong way to live in life, not just to do it for somebody, but to actually walk with them no matter how hard it is. You have been with me through so much, and I know that that is just going to continue, and you're just a very strong woman, and you are too, Aaron. So yeah, your compassion will grow. the seventh thing is, I mean, also you're just a little weird, and I but I think that's also how it helps her notice, you know, the oddball out in the group and be compassionate and walk up with them. I don't know what that says about you, Aaron, but I love your sense of humor, and you're gonna keep things lighthearted and just great. Eight, you are a dreamer. I mean that like literally. She will wake up with the most vivid dreams I have ever met in anyone. I mean, she's had a dream journal, and there's also so many spiritual implications. Sometimes like that was a weird one. But I mean, you get to wake up in bed next to her every day. I mean, she's like living another life in her dreams, and you get to experience that. And I know that will make your marriage strong, and just the way she's so excited about living every moment of every day. So, and last but not least, I mean, Susie is like the world's free spirit. And I think that's one reason. I mean, I know that marriage was kind of a hard concept to come around to. It's about, you know, a lot of bad connotations about settling down or something. And Susie would never ever settle. But when she's with you, Aaron, like there's no question that her freedom has been growing. I mean, just in the last 2 months, I just have seen, like, the stronger you guys commit to each other, the freer you are. And I once heard a really great Baptist North Carolina pastor say, you know, go where freedom is. And I think that you two are freeing each other to love more and to work more. You're free to laugh more. I've seen you free to share more, and to just live more. And so I could say more, but as you partner together in life, may you go where freedom is.
That was awesome. All right. So feel free to mingle around. We're gonna have some games down here. If you haven't seen the animals, definitely take a look. At about 8:15, it's about 30 minutes, we'll do the cake cutting and get the desserts. So try to hold off from that table, as tempting as it has been. Until then, that'd be great. And we'll see you soon. So have a good time and let's keep this going.
Yeah, thank you so much for showing up and being a part of our life, and it's just been an honor and a pleasure to celebrate this with you all. And thanks again to Tangly Woods, Jason and Janelle and their family for having this space for us. Yeah, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the night.
I'm not going to make everybody stand up the whole time. Why don't we have a seat? Go ahead and sit down.
I've got a couple words to say. Can you hear me okay?
Okay. Yeah. Is that better? Okay. I just want to thank all my family for being here. All four children. Jake is back there and his wife. And Eric. Eric's right there. And where he is...
Gretchen.
Where is Gretchen? Oh, she's way back there too with the kids. Okay, so it's so good having you here. And also my immediate family. I know a lot of the Otis don't know all my family.
He's getting married. I was just like, all the...
I said, wow, he looks like his dad.
Yeah. My goodness. That's what I hear.
Everybody says it. Mm-hmm. Sorry.
What do I?
Andrew does it.
No, he looks more like mom, yeah. I think.
I'm making a lot of video here.
Yeah, so. Good. Oh, thank you.
When you're the blur of all this is over with, then you can have something to...
Rio. Eli, Robert, Karen Lebowitz, and Laura Lowe. And second, all the way from the Big Apple, Joshua Witschker and Annie Horner. And up next, we have Ibby Pashai and Amy Smith. Up next. next, we have Landon Oda and my favorite bridesmaid, my wife, Larissa Kennedy. Best man and matron of honor, Andrew Oda and Emily Nice. And now, the moment you've all been waiting for, it's my pleasure to introduce to you Mr. and Mrs. Aaron and Susannah Oda.
Goodness. Hi.
This is Anne-Marie.